So we're going to go over the features of Megatips really quick. Maybe the most exciting thing is that we can have custom animations. The default animation setup right now is just a simple fade in and fade out. That can be changed, or you can override it on a per tooltip basis. One thing to note here is that the fade out animations are reversed. So this is shrink is assigned as fade out since it's just the fade in animation played backwards, though it will actually grow, and we can see that when we move off the trigger. Besides that, we have some standard stuff. We can assign tooltips either to UI objects or world objects like a sphere. That works nice. And we can change the orientation of the tooltip relative to the cursor. We can decide whether a tooltip will flip when it gets to the edge or not, and we can do that on a per-axis basis. This can actually come in handy if you have a tooltip on an object that's right next to the edge of the screen and you don't want it just flipping back and forth depending on what the player's doing, because that can be distracting. Besides that, we can have here's just an example of a simple tooltip. It's been overridden, so it instantly displays. It doesn't fade in. It doesn't have any delay. Here's an advanced tooltip object, which is just any UI object that we can make into a tooltip just by dragging and dropping. Besides that, we can also set the target of a tooltip instead of the cursor. We can set it to a rect transform. We can demonstrate this here. And we can change the orientation as well. If we rotate the rect transform, everything still works. We can move it, and tooltips will not overflow the edge. If they need to, they'll flip to the other side. So on and so forth. We can see here that the move target tooltip, it's been overridden, so it doesn't play quite as quickly. And this can be handy on buttons that you often interact with. You don't want a tooltip coming up all the time over a bunch of different buttons that could be distracting. So, for example, you could have tooltips attached to items which come up right away because when the player is hovering over it, they want to inspect the item. Or you can override the tooltips for buttons so that they display, say, after, in this case, a 1 second delay. If we set that to default, then we can see that it displays much quicker, and that can be annoying if we're using this button quite a lot. We can also see here that we can override, for example, the padding. So that makes it so that there's more space between the text and the border. We'll set that back. We can override the offset. So we could put a vertical offset of 100 pixels, and now we're rendering way up there. And negative one for all of this is just the default. Frames to wait setting might not be completely obvious, but the idea here is that sometimes tooltips might require a little bit of time to get initialized. So if you have, for example, several content size fitters in a dynamic tooltip that's dynamically sizing itself, that might happen over several frames. Usually a small delay will mask that, or a small fade-in time. If you have no delay or fade-in time, or if you have such a low frame rate that one frame takes longer than your delay or fade-in time, then you might see a little bit of jitter on the tooltip unless you then tell it to wait a few frames. And we actually do this on our runtime tooltips because they do use content size fitters and they might jiggle around a little bit at low FPS. And we have two different ways, or at least two different examples, of how we can generate runtime tooltips. So the first one is just taking a tooltip message component right here. And when we hover over it, it's generating that new object and then assigning it as the advanced tooltip object, which we can see. Now, if we go down here, we can see that we don't have any tooltip message. We are just calling megatips directly, and that's both fine. So in this case, we can look at the script. So we just have a non-pointer enter and exit. When we enter, we create the object, we initialize it, and then we have a drive tooltip boolean. We set it to true, and an update whenever drive tooltip is true, we just call megatips, and we just pass in the object that we've created. We say that we want to wait at least 4 frames before rendering to compensate for potential jitter as it's resizing. And then when we exit, we'd stop driving the tooltip. And this is a bit important. In case, for example, we assign the tooltip to megatips, but we exit the trigger area before it actually starts rendering the tooltip, we would need to destroy it ourselves. The way to do it to take the tooltip message and assign the advanced game object, it's pretty similar. We're just getting the tooltip message component in awake. When we enter the tooltip area, then we just, assuming that we have the tooltip message component, we will instantiate a new object and initialize it, and then set it as our advanced tooltip object in the tooltip message. And when we exit, we'll do the same thing. We'll make sure that we destroy the object, assuming that it never actually started rendering in megatips. And that's it.